All right, hallelujah. Let us stand, Israel. Our Yah, we do thank you for all things. By the power of Ruah, we need your spirit, the truth to prompt our minds, to help us to be sober, to be able to receive your truth, and bring about a transformation like the power of the message is. Let these sayings sink deep down in our hearts. Magnificent name of Yahshua. Hallelujah. You may be seated. All right. I got a letter right here. I did tell the lady that I would answer here real quick. And the letter goes like this. She says, Shalom. I'm a single mom, 41 years old, with three boys. And I also have a daughter as well. She is grown and on her own. Since the truth has awakened me for my new walk, knowing who I am and family, I just don't understand. My parents passed away years ago. I have questions about me being a single. I want to be able to protect my family the best way I can and get good advice. I live in such and such area in Dallas. All right. Well, the first thing, because I get that question a lot. You get that a lot too, don't you, Elder Doug? First thing, number one, everybody needs to work on is being impeccable in character. Notice I said work on it. Y'all know what that means, right? Be honorable. Be truthful. The reason why you need to be impeccable in character, because there are places like this that are being developed that if you're not impeccable in character, you're not moving on. I've been through enough people to know that a lot of people are not serious about this walk. And we have places developing all across this land. And it's not the fact of the matter, if it's not going to be enough places, it's just that the people are not going to be ready for the places. Just like the people are not ready for the kingdom. Is this making sense? Now, when you looked at a forced monoligamous society, this is what you're going to deal with. And just because I speak about and I talk about polygyny, that does not mean that it is a command or demand that people actually participate in that form of biblical marriage. Is that making sense? Can you cut me up in these monitors, Elder Doug, so I can hear me a little bit? People automatically think that just and assume since I talk about something that it must be a command all the way across the board. Well, what about the things we don't talk about and yet and still we esteem them as truth? I can ask everybody here a simple question, a real simple question. Very simple question. What does truth do? Why don't you want to be free then? Isn't that a good question? You know that truth sets you free. With all the truth you claim to know, yet and still you're not free. Oh, you may be free because you don't have physical chains in the aspect of them binding you around your hands and your feet. But what about here? What about all this war that goes on in the mind that the word talks about over and over and over again? See, right here, we're too Gentile in mind. I was saying to the people the other day on the community, I'll go ahead and share it with you. I said, and before I say this, let me put this out there first. To actually be here, literally, living on straightway, it's a great sacrifice. And anybody, if you ask anybody at Straightway, you would not ever see one of them walk around with their chest stuck out and their head up in the air as if they've arrived. If you watch them, every one of them has a very humble disposition. Every one of them do. You know why? Because we're the least. We're the least. Now, with that said, I tell the people, I instruct the people, I said, well, people make the mistakes in a lot of things, and I bet y'all are wondering, what's this got to do with her question? You'll see. I tell people all the time, especially here, I said, people make the mistake. You make the mistake. Israel, you here straightway. You that physically live on this land. Many of you haven't even arrived because you ain't been here long enough. It takes a long time before you even really begin to even know yourself. You're not going to know yourself for 2 years of living here on this land. Ain't no way in hell. You know how I know that? Because I've got experience. Even being in this ministry, if you are striving, it's going to take you 5 years before the light bulb even really goes off that you really even get what's going on. Then that's when you start becoming very serious. At the 10-year mark, you're probably just entering into a stage to where you can even begin maturity. I said, just begin. Because there's a lot of experiences that you have never had and you don't know. I told some of the people straight where I said, we make the mistake of assuming that when people come here, they're on the same level as we are. But they're not. Nowhere near it. Nowhere as disciplined. Are y'all getting this? That doesn't mean we're perfect. So when someone comes and dishonors the land, dishonor the rule, because you still have a lack of maturity in you, you can't even correct it. With all that said, who's going to correct a 41-year-old woman that's been out there in the world all these years if a place was provided for her? She'll come with her mind, her theology, her ideology, her perspectives, her opinions. We're a well-oiled machine. As a community, we are a well-oiled machine. And we get along just fine every single day. Not one contention amongst us, ever. No arguing, no fighting, no fussing. If any of that takes place, it usually starts with the sisters. If you don't believe me, ask them. Ask them for yourself. But they have even gotten to the point to where they are learning how to love each other. But this is a life of great sacrifice. An extreme sacrifice, which many of you are not willing to pay. You want a place to be able to be secure, like she does. But you're not prepared for that secure place. Because you're not working on this. The mothers here would tell you that they should hear from their husbands. I preach in the dining hall all the time. I say, y'all need to start preparing those children that when you tell them to shut up, they shut up. You never know when one day we may have to take off. And we could be anywhere. And all of a sudden, enemy around, but you can't take care of your child. You can't keep them quiet. And that one child compromised the whole position. We can't have that. So you have this lady out here who's in a predicament like the majority of the people in a Gentile, Western perspective, philosophy, and mindset. The churches haven't done you any good. Your family hasn't done you any good. Your religion, your own theology is no good. You're no good. So something has to change then, don't it? What's she going to do when them boys get up to a teenager? A woman cannot raise teenage boys. Why do you think we have such an influx of homosexuality? I'm not saying it's exclusive across the board. But if a man is constantly being dominated by a mother, ruled by a mother, like they do with these TV sitcoms. Mom is the one got the mouth, the power, and authority, and look at the castrated men. They're not ready to lead nothing. They get married and they grow up depending on their wives. It's too much role reversal. The order is that Satan has done a masterful job. And a woman, see, I'm using this as not only just answer her, but all these letters across the board. A woman in her position, can she submit to a godly man? Most of you can't do it. No matter how many times we remind you, the way that you will speak to, if you have a godly husband, no matter the way you speak to him is the exact same way you speak to Christ. You're not going to be convinced of it until you see him. Brother Shay, turn to Acts chapter 2, verse 42. See, when I was young, in my 20s, about 25 years old, when I really started reading the Bible, I was reading it at 12, 13, 14, 15. When I was 25 years old, I really started reading it. I mean, soaking and immersing myself in that book. And when I soaked and immersed myself in that book, I kept coming up with things that was totally different than the assembly I was in. And I would ask them questions. And they, little did I know, they couldn't give me an answer for something that they don't practice themselves. Is that making sense? They can't answer me on something like it. So the answers that I got, I understood the answers later. I didn't understand them then, but I understood their answers later. It's because they truly didn't want to live set apart. Now everybody wanted to be set apart when SHTF hit. But then you think about it. What would happen if you was to come to a place that's already set apart and your mind hasn't been nowhere near molded to be sanctified. Acts 2:42, read, Brother Shane.
And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine.
Y'all hear that? This is immediately after Pentecost. Immediately after Pentecost, they were asking Shimon Kephler, Peter, what must we do to be saved? And he kept speaking, and he got to this point right here, which you'll never hear none of these Christian churches preach or teach. You will not hear these Hebrew Israelites preach or teach. You won't hear the Messianics talk about. You won't hear none of these camps, churches, religions, or nobody speak this. You want to read from the Word, right? We always talk about the early assembly. We make our boast and brag in the early assembly and what they did and what. Can I ask y'all, sister, something? Do y'all think that the women back then had the same attitude y'all have today? Then what's the problem? The men getting in line. I had a brother just this evening come to the table and ask me a question, and I had two sisters answering, giving their opinion about the whole thing, and I jumped all over their ass. He ain't talking to them. He's talking to me. And I told them flat out, y'all need to learn how to keep your damn mouth shut. When a man is talking to you, especially when he ain't addressing you, shut your mouth. Now, what's so negative and derogatory about that? They didn't receive it that way either. You know why? Because they're mature. Why do I speak to them that way? I speak to them that way just to make sure that that spirit that is there is in check. You know, in case it wants to come and test again. Because it will test. It's not because I don't love them. I do love them. That's the reason why I corrected them. They get comfortable with speaking out of turn like that. They'll do it everywhere. And you look how free these sisters and these women are out there in the world. That's not disparaging. That's sanctifying. Yahshua in our hearts. Start verse 42 again in context. Listen.
And they continued steadfast in the apostles' doctrine.
In what doctrine?
The apostles' doctrine.
You know how many times even Paul himself said that you follow me as I spoke my gospel? My word? Y'all looked it up. How many times Paul said, my gospel? As if he had something a little bit different than everybody else. And go understand what that meaneth. The apostles had a doctrine. They had a certain doctrine that they got directly from Jesus. Directly from Jesus. And you can hear and understand exactly what they say because they're not saying anything that Jesus hadn't already said himself. But the early assembly, they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship and breaking of bread and in prayers. Is that right? Yes. Read on.
And fear came upon every soul.
And fear came upon, and you ain't got none. And today, you don't have none. But fear came upon every soul, but they didn't have none. Here we ain't got none. Ain't got none in this generation. But it says fear came upon every soul. Read on.
And many wonders and signs were done by the apostles.
When they seen these signs and wonders done by the apostles, they called them to be fearful. Now, y'all experienced a little fear and terrified. Y'all were terrified a little bit when y'all first came around. But then y'all got eased. Because it's just something you expect. But at one time you did have reverence. At one time you did have fear. When you came into my presence, now you laxed. Read.
And all that believed.
And all that believed. So if it said everybody, no, if it would have implied everybody believed, it would have said, and everybody believed. And because everybody believed, it would go on. But it says, and all that believed, singling out certain people. And all that believed, what were they?
Were together.
They were apart.
Together.
Amazing, isn't it? And all that believed were together. Now, who else preaching this? And?
Had all things common.
Had all things what?
Common.
Common. And?
Sold their possessions.
They did what?
Sold their possessions.
People ain't ready. Read.
And goods.
Mm-hmm.
And parted them to all men. As every man had need.
As every man had need. Keep reading.
And they, continuing daily, with one accord, in the temple, and breaking bread from house to house, did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart.
We can't continue daily one accord in the temple because we are the temple. We can't continue daily in a literal physical temple because the temple was destroyed. That's why when Paul came along later, he says, you are the temple of Yah. And what house are you going to build? And see, with all of us, when we're around each other, we're gathered together every day, whether two or more gathered together in my name. This ain't the first time me talking about this. I talk about this all the time. And hardly anybody out there with all the Bible you read is working towards this. And I understood this by myself at 25 years old. Amazing, isn't it? The Bible says without a vision, the people do what? This, what you see in here straightway was all because of one man's vision. And the vision is not for selfish and for selfishness and be self-absorbed. The vision is for the believers and all that believe. Y'all getting this?
Yes, sir.
See, we're in some serious trouble. Because we do a lot of reading, but we don't do no hearing. And faith come by hearing. For you to even believe what you read, you got to have the ears to hear. Boy, that's backwards from the way we learn in this world, isn't it? I feel sorry for them. Because there's nobody in all of our natural family prepared anything for. There's nobody in the assembly has got an answer for that woman who's alone, be she a divorcee or a widow. Today, there's a stigma if she went and indentured herself to become a servant. You got it so messed up in your Gentile mindset, the very order of Yah is nothing but sin to you. Y'all, the audacity y'all have is utterly amazing to me. She could have indentured herself to some Hebrew. She could be a concubine. Oh, but that's a very low grade, low order. Says who? It's a whole lot higher than an adulterer or fornicator and a whoremonger. Second in the pecking order next to a wife. But your mind, oh, I know. I know the plea, I know the cry, I know the how, I know all the challenges. In other words, Yahweh, your program is full of it. Why? Because of your mind and the heathenism that is involved in it. But if that was going to happen, a Hebrew man would be very discerning to see if he even want to take that on. Even let you in his house. Because, see, to be indentured, that means you ain't going to come and tell nobody nothing what to do. You're going to do what you're told. You're going to go to bed when you're supposed to go to bed. You're going to wake up when you're supposed to wake up. And you're going to work the way you're supposed to work. Why? Everything will be provided for you. Oh, look. See, the truth is, all you really truly need is a roof over your head and a bed. Because everything you got, you can't keep anyway unless you have a job. Because you trust in this world. Well, Pastor, what would happen if they just come and take everything from me? They ain't going to take nothing to me. I'll give it to them. I came in this world with nothing. I'm going to leave with nothing. But if they take everything, no matter where I go, I'm always going to have something because of the investment of this word that is hidden in his heart. The way maker. Amazing, isn't it? Yeah, no matter where I go, Yah will be there. See, this is foreign talk to this generation. Can you imagine what type of crackpot and maverick that Jesus looked like in his day? No wonder they killed him. The outcry was so great that even if there was a few people for him, couldn't hear it. Amazing, huh? Do we really truly believe the book? I feel sorry for this. I really truly do. But that's all I can do is feel sorry. Well, you don't know her. Yeah, I do too. She was reared and raised in America. She ain't no different than you. Ain't too hard to figure out American woman. I moved a woman here that had 3 children. Only 15 years later to fall away. Open up the doors to my home. I done experienced you before. I'm not condemning her. I'm just telling you that you don't know your heart like you think you do. Most of you ain't ready for the sacrifice. You should be moving to get ready. Shouldn't take too long either. Because we had crap hit the fan. We couldn't let half of y'all even come here. You tap the community and order things. Because here, you're going to do what you're told. What do you do when you're in the military? What you told? What do you do when you're on the job? So why is it a problem when we come in the assembly with Christ? If you don't muzzle the ox that treadeth out the corn, then why would you muzzle the one who you that is la- that is worthy is labor his labor is worthy of his hire? It just don't make sense. You'll feed an ox. You'll give him all the grain he wants. Utterly amazing, isn't it? All right. I tell you what, why are we here? Oh, somebody else asked me a question because what? How you pronounce that word, brother Elias? Apologetics? I talked about that before, apologetics. They asked me, what is apologetics? How many people like know what apologetics is? You make an apology, right? That's what it is, right? It was something. Go to 1 Peter 3:15. Hope we may get to the Bible study. Maybe this is it. I don't know. 1 Peter 3:15. Brother Shane, when you have it, go ahead and read. And y'all understand, I'm a dumb man. I'm an ignorant man. I am a very ignorant man. So the only thing you can take note of is I've been with Christ. Other than that, I'm ignorant. I freely admit it. Read.
But sanctify Yahweh Elohim in your heart.
What are you supposed to do?
Sanctify.
Sanctify Yahweh your Elohim in your what?
Hearts.
He's supposed to be set apart in your hearts. All right, read on.
And
what?
Be ready
be
always.
Be ready always.
To give an answer to.
All right, now stop. There go your apology or apologetics. It's apologia in the Greek. Answer. You're supposed to be ready at all times to defend with an answer, with meekness. Anything that somebody asks of you concerning your belief. Finish reading.
To give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason of the hope that is in you with meekness and fear.
That's all it is. It's just being able to defend, to be able to give an answer. With no, notice, the character should be with meekness and with what? And with fear. See, what you're doing is you would answer them the same way if you was trying to draw someone.
Yes, yes, sir.
Not the very opposite that you see was displayed today. Is that making sense? So this apologetics is nothing more than a defense of the gospel. Now, what is the gospel? Well, if you ask a lot of people what the gospel is, most of them will say it's that 12 tribes chart. I ain't never read that one before. Huh? And while we're there, go to Philippians, the third chapter, start at verse 1. See, have we not been warned about another gospel, another message, and all this being preached and taught? It's sitting right in front of us. They all out there. Every one of them out. You can't see the people that are in the book having the right voice. It would be something if the book didn't call it. But to already call it. Phew, and people are still confused. Flesh and blood is not going to inherit the kingdom of Yah. And you're going to make a gospel out of it? That's the good news. Read first verse. Read the first three verses.
Finally, my brethren. Rejoice in Yahweh.
Rejoice in who?
Yahweh.
Come on.
To write the same things to you. To me, indeed, it is not grievous, but for you, it is safe.
Uh-huh.
Beware of dogs.
Stop. Look at that. Beware of what?
Dogs.
And it ain't talking about them four-legged dogs either. Beware of?
Dogs.
Read on.
Beware of evil workers.
Beware of what?
Evil workers.
Most of you spend your time looking at them. You would know an evil worker if you saw one. You can't know an evil worker if you are evil yourself. Come on.
Beware of the concision.
Come on.
For we are the circumcision.
We are the what?
The circumcision. Which worship Yah in the spirit and rejoice in Christ Jesus and have no confidence in the flesh.
Amazing, huh? See, you already got 95% of anyone who profess any type of religion exempt from this because they don't even have the Spirit. They don't believe the Spirit according to the way that the Bible lays it out. And since they don't have the Spirit, they have no other choice but to put confidence in the flesh. Amazing, isn't it? Utterly amazing, the hypocrisy. The hypocrisy. Go to 1 Corinthians 15, start at verse 51. Just amazing. And we'll get started here. But you're going to have a total, complete... I had to change my mind. Believe it or not, I am not the same man that I used to be just 5 years ago. I'm definitely not the same man I was 25 years ago. The only thing I can relate to that man is a picture. Some of you still the same. Amazing, isn't it? How else are we going to understand this book unless we have somebody in front of us preaching like the book says? The whole essence of preaching is insult. And adding it even to injury. Preach the word. Be instant in season, out of season, reprove and rebuke. Now, who want to hear that word? You can't get any exhortation until you get finished reproving and rebuking. Are we not in a time that people are not going to endure sound doctrine? Are we not in a time that people run looking for people that's going to tickle and itch their ears to death? Go to the assembly of your choice. You ain't nobody talking the way I talk. You definitely got to be sending of y'all to come to the way I talk. You know what y'all had to do? Sister Brittany is a lawyer. She's an attorney, okay? You know what he had to get through just in order to get through an educated mind like that? To hear somebody like me? I speak as a buffoon. Even type worse. First Corinthians 15:51, read.
Behold.
Uh-huh.
I show you a mystery.
We got a mystery.
We shall not all sleep.
But we're going to all be changed in a moment in the twinkling of an eye at the last trump. Keep going.
For the trumpet shall sound.
And then what's going to happen?
And the dead shall be raised incorruptible.
Keep going.
And we shall be changed.
Mm-hmm.
For this corruptible must put on incorruption.
Y'all hear that? Come on.
And this mortal must put on immortality.
You better get your mind ready for the new one. You can't put old wine into new wineskins. And some of you trying to put an old mind into a brand new wineskin that's waiting on you. Now the word, it makes perfect sense. Be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing. Why? So you get into the new skin, it don't bust.
But Pat, we like that old wine.
Read.
So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin. And the strength of sin is the law.
Y'all hear that? The law is the only thing that's going to correct us. And the law is the only thing that's going to prevent us from feeling the sting of death when our time comes. Did y'all hear what I just got finished saying? Or did it go over your head? Did it fly past you? Did you miss it? You ever seen anybody die and how hard they struggle to stay alive? Just to grasp for the next breath? It's too much sin. In this world, conventional medicine, they've done everything possible to remove the sting of sin. They pump you up with so much morphine and everything else, you don't feel nothing. Boy, we got a lot to learn, don't we? See, out of all my years of preaching, this is as smart as I've done got. Isn't that something? And to those people out there that are wise, I speak as a fool. But can I speak wise? Oh, you better believe I can. Why should I? You speak wise to them that have wisdom. Ain't too many of them. All that for one letter. A testimony of a witness must be subject to cross-examination. Any witness. Corroboration. Evidence. This is what it is. I got this actually from Merriam-Webster Dictionary. Evidence that confirms and supports a statement of theory or finding confirmation. All right. Exodus 20:16, thou shalt not bear false witness against thy what? Who said this? Deuteronomy 7:6, out of the mouth of two witnesses At the mouth of two witnesses or three witnesses, shall he that is worthy of death be put to what? Death. But at the mouth of what? One witness, he shall not be put to death. Numbers 35:30. Whoso killeth any person, the murderer shall be put to death by the mouth of witnesses. But one witness shall not testify against any person to cause him to die. Now, y'all listen to me. You remember we just got finished. It was no more maybe Shabbat or maybe last scripture study that we went over things that seem like a lie. It would normally seem like a lie to us. Are you following me? Know how to separate the righteous from the wicked. Because you're not under any more obligation to tell the truth to an enemy seeking to harm or destroy you. Y'all hear that? Truth is reserved for normal, healthy relationships. The scriptural law of testimony does not permit torture or coerced confessions. Y'all do notice that, right? You don't see no torture in our law that y'all's giving us. However, voluntary confession is possible, but two or more witnesses are required for a conviction. Did y'all hear that? Y'all remember Achan's confession? Required confirming evidence before he was sentenced to be executed. Brother Shane, go to Joshua chapter 7. Start at verse 19. We're going to read on down to verse 26. Listen to the book very closely. Listen to the book. Read when you have it.
And Joshua said to Achan, "My son, give, I pray thee, glory to Yahweh Elohim of Israel, and make confession unto him, and tell me now what thou hast done. Hide it not from me."
Now, Joshua isn't just anybody. He's one in charge. Are you following? Read on.
And Achan answered Joshua and said, "Indeed, I have sinned against Yahweh Elohim of Israel, and thus have I done. When I saw among the spoils a goodly Babylonish garment."
A good what kind of garment?
Babylonish.
Read on.
"And 200 shekels of silver, and a wedge of gold of 50 shekels weight. Then I coveted them and took them. And behold, they are hid in the earth in the midst of my tent, and silver under it. So Joshua sent messengers, and they ran unto the tent, and behold, it was hid in his tent, and the silver under it. And they took them out of the midst of the tent, and brought them unto Joshua, and unto all the children of Israel, and laid them out before Yahweh. And Joshua and all Israel with him took Achan, the son of Zerah, and the silver, and the garment, and the wedge of gold, and his sons, and his daughters, and his oxen, and his asses, and his sheep, and his tent, and all that he had."
You know the reason why? See, if just one person would have went and ratted him out, they would have saved themselves. Did y'all hear that? Because see, now we're dealing with Israel amongst Israel. If just one person would have ratted him out, they would have but saved themselves. You know, the prophets even talk about that too. Though Noah, Daniel, and Job be in it, they will neither deliver son or daughter, but they will but save themselves. Since nobody said anything, well, the whole family's coming on the carpet. And let's see what happened. Read.
"And they brought them unto the valley of Achor. And Joshua said, Why hast thou troubled us? Yahweh shall trouble thee this day. And all Israel stoned him with stones and burned them with fire after they had stoned them with stones. And they raised over him a great heap of stones unto this day. So Yahweh turned from the fierceness of his anger. Wherefore the name of that place was called the Valley of Achor unto this day."
Because if Israel hadn't judged this thing and done this thing right, They were going to bring a curse upon themselves, and Yah was going to get the whole entire nation. See here, straightway, you just can't be going off and do your own little thing. Especially if you're going to sin secretly. We're going to find out anyway. Sooner or later, your sin always finds you out. And here it does. On this land, it does. You have to live here to realize how powerful Yah is. And because they judged righteously, they turned Yah from the fierceness that he had thought to do to all of Israel. Y'all getting this?
Yes, sir.
Most of you in this business, man, you don't rat out nobody. What if they're bringing a curse on us? What if they're bringing a curse on us? How can a place, and how can Yah bless a place where he's grieved because he can't stand sin? How's your home doing? That's a great responsibility. Are y'all hearing this? Deuteronomy 19:15. One witness shall not rise up against a man for any iniquity or for any sin. And any sin that he sinneth at the mouth of two witnesses or at the mouth of three witnesses shall a matter be established. You know, the internet is replete with slander and people bearing false witness. Just because the world has no discipline and no honor, when we hear messages like this, that don't mean you go participate in it. Y'all hearing me? This is what the law says. If a false witness rise up against any man to testify against him that which is wrong, then both the men between whom the controversy is shall stand before Yahweh, before the priests and the judges, which shall be in those days. See, now what we do is say, there ain't no priests, there ain't no judges. We ain't standing before y'all. Yeah, he did. He still got a program. He still got a program. Works too. And the judges shall make diligent inquisition. And behold, if the witness be a false witness and have testified falsely against his brother, then shall you do unto him as he had thought to have done unto his brother, so shall thou put away the evil among you. You know, there's an intent behind everything we do, right? And those which remain shall hear and fear, and shall henceforth commit no more any such evil among you. He calls this evil. And thy eye shall not pity, but life shall go for life, and eye for an eye, and tooth for tooth, and hand for hand, and foot for foot. Proverbs 9:5, a false witness shall not be unpunished. See, we expect when we bear false witness and we do all this and so on, all this wickedness and stuff, that, okay, I repent, and then we're supposed to just let the stuff just go on by. And he that speaketh lies shall not escape. Proverbs 25:18, a man that bear false witness against his neighbor is a maul and a sword, and a sharp arrow. One reason why people bear false witness, and believe me, you have to understand what the Bible says false witness is, not what you say. The only reason why a lot of people bear false witness is just so they can stroke their own ego. Why would you want to bring an evil name or an evil report upon someone? Because whatever you wish to anyone is coming to you. Matthew 18:15, moreover, if thy brother shall trespass against thee, go and tell him his fault between thee and him alone. And if he shall hear thee, you have gained your brother. But if he will not hear thee, then take with thee one or two more, that in the mouth of two or three witnesses, and every word be established. That's straight from the law, isn't it? And if he shall neglect to hear them, tell it to the assembly. And if he neglect to hear the assembly, let him be unto thee as a what? Heathen and a pagan. That's when you put them out. Why? When you put them out, you put away the what? Evil, don't you? 1 Corinthians 13:1. This is the third time I am coming to you. In the mouth of two or three witnesses shall every word be established. Don't forget to read a little bit before and after. 1 Timothy 5:19. Just give me precepts here. Against an elder, receive not an accusation, but before two or three what? That's why I said earlier, what can we expect from the assembly when you got elders accusing elders and they don't even know? You know, more than anything, we're supposed to be defending each other. We should be covering each other. That's what we should do. In hopes of perfection. Hebrews 10:28, he that despised Moses' law died without mercy under two or three what? Witnesses. Under two or three witnesses. So y'all's very serious about this bearing witness, this bearing false witness stuff. In this society, we can't even talk without it. You can't carry on a conversation without it. So immersed in the Gentile mindset. See, we read this over and over again, but it doesn't bring the impact like a study does. I believe that the scriptures tell us clearly because a sentence against an evil work is not executed speedily. Our hearts are exercised to do evil because we think that there's no payment going to come behind it. But I beg you to differ. See, now we're dealing with spiritual things. There's no peace to the wicked. Spiritually, some of you still fighting the same stuff you have fought all your life. And you haven't gotten any better. Chances are you probably bear false witness against someone. Or despise y'all's commandment somewhere. No amount of deliverance even helps. See, repentance is more than just echoing words. Same words. Has to mean business from the heart. One sinner can destroy much good. That don't mean good is going to be destroyed. But they sure do have an intent to destroy it, though, don't they? Why? Full of sin. If you're dealing with things in your life, mind, still have same old struggle, same old problem, you have got no further look than some hidden sin that you can't see. Y'all promised peace to the righteous. That's what he said. I know it's hard to believe in this world that you can live in peace, but you can. You really, truly can live in peace and be at peace. But you have to hate the garment that is spotted by the flesh. You have to despise it. And we continue to keep revisiting the same old attitude, same old mindset stuff, it's because you don't hate that garment that spots the flesh. Because to lose that garment, you'd be naked and exposed for the sinner that you are. And you're comfortable with your wardrobe. I don't expect people, too many people in the world to even hear and begin to understand anyway, because it's not for the majority of the people in the world. I end on this. You should be able to clearly see who are the false apostles, false prophets, false preachers, false teachers. All you have to do is look at their character. It clearly tells you who they are. Just because a person falls short don't mean that their character is damaged. What you do is you see what they do after they have fallen short. That tells you the type of person that they are. What do they do about their situation after they've gone through? That's the real person. No wonder the Bible says there is no condemnation. I'm glad a lot of you are getting strengthened out there because you're actually hearing the word, hearing the message, but make no mistake about it, we're in a very serious war. A very serious war, and some of you are still losing after all these years, even with all this information put in front of you. And that ought not to be. We have an opportunity before the king comes. We have an opportunity, we do, before the king comes, to make sure that the generation coming behind us, if they're not going to follow this truth, at least they've heard it. There's one thing about giving your word. It binds you. Makes you obligated. How do you feel if you don't perform your word? The Bible says that there are people who are past feeling. That's why I started off tonight by saying, be impeccable. The scriptures have not spoken in vain, though. This thing right here, this tongue, it is an unruly evil. And it is full of deadly poison. It is. And this thing right here has sent more people to damnation than anything. So like 1 Peter 3:15 said, sanctify Yahshua in your heart. You always be ready to give an answer to any man, anybody, for the reason of the hope that lies in you. Now you can't do that if you're living on no hope. How many people you talk to about the Messiah? That when opportunity presents itself, you're overwhelmed with joy to share the good news. We don't have that going on in this generation because we're so loaded down with our own filth and corruption. We can't even do what we were even put here to do. Let your light shine before men that they may see your good works. Let us stand. Oh, y'all, it's good. Hey, I'm working on, I got a team that's working on this meeting place, this hotel meeting place in Virginia. We'll get it locked down. As soon as I get it locked down, we'll put it out on YouTube and let everybody know. Hallelujah. So I can show y'all how to put a slanderer in his place. It's going to be a good, vigorous debate. Sure is. I like debating liars. It's a wonderful thing. But y'all do notice the difference in the character of your pastor, though, don't you?
Yes, sir.
You notice that if I'm talking about somebody, I call their name. I don't speak in innuendos. Now who the coward is. I don't speak in riddles and terms. I speak just like our people did in the book. If I got something to say to you, I will call your name so there's no room for misunderstanding. You don't have to worry about discernment. Hallelujah. Yah's good. Father, we thank you for your truth. Pray these sins sink deep down our hearts. In the magnificent name of Yahshua. Hallelujah. King coming.
Uh-oh, look at him looking.